Surprise, surprise. Republican Glenn Youngkin hasn't stood up to the woke pogrom on all things Southern in Virginia. I'll talk about this on episode 769 of The Brion McClanahan Show.
It's time to think locally and act locally. Welcome to The Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to The Brion McClanahan Show. Glad to have you back on the program. Very glad to be here. Look, you can support the show painlessly by simply rating, reviewing, and subscribing to the podcast. Leave it that five-star review wherever you get your podcasts. Leave a text review where you can. You can do that at Apple Podcasts, of course, at anchor.fm. You can leave a text review of the episodes there. You can also comment on it on the YouTube channel if you're watching on YouTube. That's a great way to help the algorithm there. Also, if you want to support the show financially, you can click on that little super thanks button under the video. You can also go to anchor.fm. You can give me a few pennies there, help the podcast, or go to brionmcclanahan.com/support and throw a few pennies my way that way. Lots of great ways to support the show. So let's talk about the topic of the day. And, of course, that is Glenn Youngkin. Now, I cautioned people on Glenn Youngkin when he was elected. I said, look, don't expect major things to happen. And we're seeing this now all over the place in Virginia, particularly with the culture war. Don't expect major things to happen. Glenn Youngkin is trying to position himself to run for president in the future. And he doesn't think he can do that by waging the culture war in Virginia. In contrast to Ron DeSantis, who has gone on a full-on assault on the culture war, and of course he's taking a lot of political heat for this, Glenn Youngkin is hanging back because he thinks that's going to position himself in a better way to get left-leaning support for his campaign. Now, I'm not so certain about that. I mean, look, the left hates Glenn Youngkin just like they do Ron DeSantis. And of course, recently Ron DeSantis decided, or the state of Florida decided to cancel an AP Black History class because they said the curriculum didn't really meet the topic that they were supposedly promoting, which of course is African American history. And he said, of course, in Florida, we teach African American history in our classes. And I think anybody that teaches American history does. His point was that this class didn't focus on that solely. It also talked about things like gender studies and defunding the police and all kinds of things that really had nothing to do with Black history in America. So it was a politically charged class. And as I talked about last week with historians wondering why the profession is dying, well, it's because of things like that. Most Americans don't want their history to be politicized. They want to understand what history was. And of course, there's bad things in history. There's good things in history. Everyone knows this. But they don't want it to become a weapon to be used to bludgeon them over the head, particularly in the culture wars. So Americans are bristling at this kind of left-wing activism masquerading as history. And that's the real problem. We know that a lot of these left-wingers don't really understand what they're talking about anyways. And I highlighted that again last week with a comment that a professor at the University of Connecticut said about the 10th Amendment and Calhoun and the Constitution. She doesn't really know what she's talking about. It's sad that these people have any kind of sway in modern American society. They're completely clueless. But I want to talk about a piece on Youngkin that was published in the American Spectator. And unfortunately, the author of this piece, George Neumeier, died very suddenly of malaria. At least that's the official cause in Africa on the Ivory Coast. It's a sad thing, but you know, he was a great writer for American Spectator for years. Was a ardent defender of Catholicism and traditional Catholicism, but very conservative individual. And he wrote this piece. And I mean, this is heroic. In many ways, because you don't really find mainstream publications like the American Spectator or others really taking on these establishment Republicans who go along with the woke agenda. And when I say that go along with the woke agenda, what I'm talking about are things like Confederate monuments, Confederate symbols, Confederate names, or in this case, some names of some community colleges in Virginia that are now being changed. And Youngkin has not stopped it. And we can say this about, for example, the Arlington Confederate Monument, sculpted by Moses Ezekiel, the real reconciliation monument. Glenn Youngkin, this is on Virginia property. Glenn Youngkin could work to try to stop this, but he's not. The state of Virginia is not doing anything about it, really. They're not doing anything about Confederate monuments being removed. They could have done, Youngkin could have come into office and reversed what Ralph Northam had done, but he didn't. He could have said, look, these are all state issues. They're going back where they were. We're putting them back up. You're not taking these things down. And the city of Richmond is going to pay for it. They're going to pay to put these back up. These are nationally recognized historic sites. You're not taking this stuff down. They could have done that. But Youngkin refused to do it. And of course, let people like Anne McLean go because she dared speak out in a politically incorrect way about the war or Southern history. It's a joke. Virginia is one of the most prominent Southern states in the history of the United States, if not the most prominent Southern state in the history of the United States. The only one that you could say would equal it would be South Carolina. But those two states were the dominant Southern states throughout most of American history. And you look at the importance of people that have come from Virginia. I mean, this is tremendous. One of the things that I want to say about Virginia, modern Northern progressives don't like Robert E. Lee and Stonewall Jackson, not because of slavery or because of the war. They don't like these two men because those two Virginians inspired men in a way that no Northerner ever has. The only one that equals them or maybe surpasses them is another Virginian, George Washington. So you've got three Americans that inspired men in a way that no other American, Northern American in particular, ever has. And they have to tear that down. They have to elevate their dopey heroes and take down these people because those three men, and Washington's under attack too, those three men inspired Americans in a way that no one in the North ever has or ever will. I mean, you go back throughout American history, the only one maybe in the 20th century in terms of a military leader, and this is what I'm talking about, a military leader that inspired men the way they did was Dwight Eisenhower. And of course, not just militarily, but also politically. Eisenhower was a very popular president. So you could say Eisenhower, perhaps. But when you look at the annals of history, and this is something that the Abbeville Institute 1607 project is going to work on, but the military side of this, people like Winfield Scott and Chesty Puller, another great Southerner, and George Patton, who of course was, loved his Southern Confederate roots. These men inspired people, but Lee, Jackson, and Washington did it in ways that no one else can, and that's why statues were erected in their honor. You see, Grant didn't, Sherman didn't. I mean, you go back and look at the roster of Union general officers, none of them did. None of them inspired their men the way that Lee and Jackson did. A kind of devotion that no one else had, no other Northern general or even after that, American general really had throughout American history. They just didn't have it. So, that's why they hate these people, because Americans rightly recognize Lee and Jackson and, of course, Washington as the real symbol of the American character, and they have to take that down. So, let me talk about this piece by the late George Neumeyer, of course, again, unfortunately, and sadly, Neumeyer died not long before I've recorded this. But the piece says, Glenn Youngkin won the governorship of Virginia largely on a platform of anti-wokeness. This is true. I mean, the school board moms, right? The moms that were going out in Virginia and trying to take down some of the woke curriculum and things happening in Virginia. That's why Youngkin won. And of course, all the information that had come out where you had the government spying on people at school board meetings and are these people a threat to the state and all kinds of things. But Youngkin won because he was willing to take on the politically correct agenda, the woke agenda, in schools. And he should have followed through on that as governor, but he hasn't. He says he campaigned against the critical race theory propaganda that was spreading through Virginia's public schools. As governor, he has maintained that stance for the most part. He recently scuttled plans at the Virginia Department of Education to remove references on statewide tests to George Washington as the father of the country and James Madison as the father of the Constitution. So, I mean, again, Virginia is trying to take down their own splendid history. Now, I could argue about Madison being the father of the Constitution. I think that's a misnomer. But Washington, the father of the country? Absolutely. There's no America. There's no United States without George Washington. I mean, it doesn't exist. And all the efforts to tear him down is because, of course, all the leftist ideologues don't think the United States ever lived up to its lofty idea, which, again, is the whole point of the 1607 Project. There wasn't any lofty idea. Conservatives, this is where I would criticize Ron DeSantis. He runs around saying that America essentially is founded on this idea, and we have all the, you know, we didn't have any abolition until that. And he's wrong about that. I mean, there were abolition groups before we had the Declaration of Independence written. Absolutely, there were abolition groups. And a lot of it was based on religion. But then again, that was also uneven. And of course, that line in the Declaration did lead to people beginning to question slavery in America. There's no doubt about that. But America wasn't founded on this particular idea. It was a decentralized federal republic based on the traditions of the Anglo-American traditions of federalism. I mean, that's what America is. It's why the Declaration was written. The British were not following through on the ancient constitutions of their fathers, and that was in government power, not this idea of America. And again, when we get the 1607 Project finished, you'll see more of that. So Neumeyer says, but strangely, his administration is not challenging the politically correct renaming of Virginia's community colleges. In fact, John Mayaris, Virginia's attorney general, has fought a civil lawsuit against the renaming of the schools. So the attorney general, the man appointed by Glenn Youngkin to be, I guess they elect the attorney general in Virginia, but either way, the state attorney general is fighting lawsuits to prevent the name changes. Now, I believe Mayaris is a Republican, but I don't know. I haven't looked this up. I don't know that 100%. But regardless, Youngkin's not trying to change this. In July, reported Northern Virginia Daily, Noel Shaw Bell, who is the counsel with the Virginia Attorney General's Office and for the Virginia Community College System, defended the schools against a lawsuit filed by Woodstock-based attorney Brad Pollock, who is also a member of the Shenandoah County Board of Supervisors, on behalf of four Shenandoah County applicants: William Holtzman, founder of Holtzman Oil Corporation; Gregory Kowatsky; Wade Gwynn; and Randall Heyman. Holtzman is a prominent donor to the Virginia GOP. The lawsuit sought to reverse the name change of the schools, arguing that the proper procedure for the switch wasn't followed, according to the Northern Virginia Daily. But the lawyer at Mayaris sent to court, Shaw Bell, dismissed the lawsuit as a meritless challenge to the internal operation of Virginia's community colleges, and Judge Joanne Alper dismissed the case in Shenandoah County Circuit Court, reported Northern Virginia Daily. The case is currently under appeal. So, again, you had these four applicants say the process was not followed, the proper procedures were not followed for changing these names. And, of course, this is not just Virginia community colleges. You're seeing it all over Virginia and all over the South. Places that, and if you've got the naming commission going after Fort Benning, now I guess it's going to be Fort Howell Moore, whatever you got. But you've got this stuff going on all over the South. People are trying to take down anything that's named after anyone they deem to be anti-American. And essentially that's what they're saying. These people are anti-American. They don't fit with American history, when in fact they're purely American. And I find this just completely reprehensible. It's barbaric. But it's what communists do. I mean, communists and revolutionary ideologues tear down any attachment to tradition because that does not fit with their perceived ideological direction. This is why they do it. There's no other reason for it. So in this particular case, you have these four claimants saying these things do not follow proper procedure. Judge throws it out. There is no procedural due process here, but that doesn't matter. Judge throws it out when it comes to renaming these colleges. So Neumeyer says, this matter has some conservatives puzzled. Why, they wonder, is the Youngkin administration in effect defending the woke policy of his predecessor Ralph Northam? Calls from the American Spectator to the office of Jason Miaris inquiring about this matter were not returned. Oddly, the issue of the woke renaming of Virginia's community colleges never surfaced during the 2021 campaign in Virginia. And yet, it was an open outrage pushed not by communities, but by a left-wing ideologue then at the top of the schools, Glenn DuBois, the former chancellor of the Virginia Community College System. So this wasn't pushed by people in the of the communities. We need to change these community colleges. This was pushed by the chancellor of the Virginia Community College System. We thought this was a good idea. We need to do this because we don't have inclusive community colleges because of a name. Now, again, I've told this story before, but you've seen some of this, some of the rumblings here in various places in Alabama. George Wallace was the founder of the Alabama Community College System, and the schools all had very Southern names. And so years ago, when Yale was looking to rename Calhoun College, they had a little reporter from Yale come down to Alabama, and there's a community college in Alabama, Calhoun Community College, and he was trying to interview people, and people wouldn't talk about it, but there was one student they interviewed, and she was an African-American student, and this reporter asked her, he said, you know, how do you feel going to a school that's named after someone who hated you? Of course, Calhoun didn't hate anybody, but who, except for maybe Yankees, who hated you. And her response was, I mean, amazing. She said, so wait a second. You mean to tell me there's people that go to Yale? Now, you think about this. This person's at a community college in a rural part of the state. Not a lot of money in this area. It's not very affluent. She's an African-American student trying to claw her way to a better way of life, to a better point in life by trying to get a community college education. She's starting at a community college, and you've got a privileged student from Yale, and you look at that. I mean, Yale, $50,000 a year just to go to Yale. I think that, I mean, that's might be even be higher. I don't know what Yale's tuition and fees and board and everything else, but say $50,000 a year. And you've got a community college student who's might have been on financial aid, maybe paying out of pocket, who knows? But, you know, contrast that to what, $5,000, $6,000 a year? And she said, you mean to tell me that there are students that go to Yale that can't go to school because of the name on the building? That's just stupid. I loved it. It was amazing because it showed how out of touch these little privileged twits are. You've got, and community colleges serve a very important purpose in America, and that is getting people who don't have the means or the background or maybe the grades the chance to achieve something better. It could be a technical degree. It could be a college transfer degree. But these people have a chance because of the cost. The name to most of these people, I would say probably 99.9% of the people attending all of these schools is completely irrelevant. They don't care. They just want to get a degree so they can improve their life. But you've got academics, people with degrees, who sit around and think about how this is, you know, traumatizing for students when probably 99.9% of them could not care what is on the building. They don't care. They just want to go get a degree. They might be a first person in their family to go to school. They might be the first person, you know, an economically depressed area to have a chance to go to school. And so, you know, that's the amazing thing about all this. You've got privileged people that really don't understand the plight of these people that they're supposedly defending, who just simply want to go and do better for themselves. The naming of a Virginia community college should reflect the values of inclusive and accessible education articulated in the VCCS mission statement, with special emphasis on diversity, equity, and opportunity. and be relevant to the students it seeks to serve and to the geography of its service region, declared the Virginia State Board of Community Colleges. Through his manipulation and strong-arming of this board, Du Bois orchestrated name changes across the state last year. Lord Fairfax Community College became Laurel Ridge Community College. John Tyler Community College became Bridgepoint Community College. Thomas Nelson Community College became Virginia Peninsular Community College. And Patrick Henry Community College became Patrick and Henry Community College. I mean, look at this. So they go after Lord Fairfax, who, of course, the Fairfaxes were one of the most prominent families in Virginia, a loyalist family, by the way. Very good friends with George Washington, but Fairfax County, are we going to rename Fairfax County in Virginia? I mean, it's just ridiculously stupid, but are we going to do that? John Tyler, of course, you can't love John Tyler, a president of the United States, but he committed the cardinal sin of siding with the Confederacy, as did, of course, by the way, many, many of the descendants of Virginians, prominent Virginians, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, George Washington, or family members, the Lees. I mean, you go down the line and you've got all these people that had Confederates in their family. Patrick Henry, right? The man who said, "Give me liberty or give me death." One of the most important Americans in the history of the United States. You can't have his name anymore. This is how ridiculous this stuff is. Du Bois cast these admired historical figures. Tyler was America's 10th president. Nelson and Henry were heroes of the American Revolution. And Lord Fairfax was a friend of George Washington, who'd administered Virginia during pre-revolutionary British period as slaveholding monsters. We know lots of people whose ancestors were enslaved, were marginalized, were clearly taken advantage of, said Du Bois. And what do you say to these students when they're looking at some of these names? I don't know. They probably don't care. Okay, yeah, we're going to John Tyler Community College. Who cares? We're going to Patrick Henry Community College. Who cares? And they don't care. And of course, Neumeier talks about this. He says, but few students were clamoring for the name changes, nor were Virginia taxpayers who had to pick up the significant costs for it. The movement to change the names came from Du Bois and other critical race theory proponents for whom such iconoclasm is central to their left-wing revolution. To discredit America's traditional political order and replace it with a new one, they must discredit America's founders. Now, of course, you look at this, you had three people that were in that founding period, Nelson and Fairfax and, of course, Henry. Now, Fairfax was a loyalist, but then you had John Tyler wasn't a founder, but, I mean, John Tyler, his father was a founder. His father supped with Thomas Jefferson, so did John Tyler himself. He ate at the table with Thomas Jefferson. And of course, John Tyler's grandson is still alive. He just had one die. But his grandson, and John Tyler was the 10th president of the United States. This is a man that had long ties to Virginia, all throughout Virginia history. The Tyler family is just so important. And of course, to American history, look at Texas. And so the Tyler name is important, but no. He's a slaveholding monster. To create a new America in their own left-wing image, progressives must erase American history. That's what I mean. This is a communist, right out of the communist playbook. Consequently, these battles over name changes are far from trivial. The victors in them will determine America's future. True, again, very true. Today, I don't know why anyone would want to name a community college after a British lord, Du Bois said as he moved to change Lord Fairfax Community College to Laurel Ridge Community College. It just doesn't make any sense. Only a woke revolutionary determined to cut America off from its origins would make such a fatuous statement. I mean, it's true. Fatuous statement. I mean, yeah, we have a county named after the guy. In Virginia, one of the most prosperous counties, by the way, in Virginia, named after Fairfax. Virginia Rep. Bob Good opposed the name change to Lord Fairfax Community College, noting the ahistorical nihilism that lies behind it, a nihilism that would mean altering almost everything in the state. Quote, this decision is a direct response to the cancel culture movement, which looks to reject people and ideas that do not fit the current politically correct narrative, he wrote to Du Bois. Efforts such as these encourage an endless cycle of renaming institutions, buildings, and cities across the country under the ruse of political wokeness. Which, again, is 100% true. Given the stakes in these controversies, why would the Youngkin administration support the woke renaming of community colleges? My RS has no obligation to send lawyers from his office to defend the change. The Youngkin administration has changed course on other destructive northern era policies. Why not that one? That's a good question. Well, because Glenn Youngkin doesn't think this is going to have any political capital for him. I mean, that's really it. This is the grand old stupid party we're talking about here. They only think that they're only going to attack the things they think they can have any political capital. Generally, I mean, this is how Republicans operate. They're spineless. So Youngkin isn't going to do anything that's going to rock the boat in areas that he doesn't think is going to gain him points. Monique Miles, a black female conservative, worked in the office of IRS as a deputy attorney general of government operations and transactions. But she says that he fired her after the Washington Post conducted a smearing probe of social media posts she had written about the protests on January 6, 2021. In an interview with the American Spectator, Miles said that the Youngkin administration is not as staunchly anti-woke as it appears. She said that there are a lot of never-Trumpers in it who are hypersensitive to what appears in the liberal media. There is a culture of fear, she concluded. Well, of course. Youngkin is not very conservative. He is a corporate conservative. And I think, you know, never-Trumpers, not a bad way to put it, but he kind of used that now as this demarcation line for, you know, maybe more conservatives and less conservatives, you know, maybe establishment and anti-establishment. But that battle's been going on for years. I mean, this is not something new because of Trump, as it's been pointed out several times. National conservatives are understandably rooting for Youngkin, who represents a welcome measure of common sense in a politically tricky state. But they also know from bitter experience that selectively conservative Republican governors don't wear well over time. The woke renaming of Virginia's community colleges may seem like a small matter, but it isn't. It goes to whether or not the state will remain connected to American history and tradition if the nihilistic vision of Du Bois prevails, and does so not in spite of the Youngkin administration, but because of it, conservatives won't forget this betrayal. And of course, this goes for all kinds of conservative governors. You know, you got former Governor Nikki Haley out there trying to think she's going to run for president. Nobody's going to support her. Kristi Noem, who backtracked on some things, that crushed her hopes. So you've got people out there that think they can buckle to the wokies, and this is somehow going to endear them to conservatives across the United States. This is why, again, Ron DeSantis, for all the problems that he has, and even Donald Trump, I'll say this about both, even though their attacks are misguided, the 1776 Commission report, the things DeSantis says, and I'll talk about that issue of ideology tomorrow on the show, but even though their defenses are misguided, at least they're doing something. I will say that. They're trying to do something. It's just you have to get the something right, because if you don't, you're simply playing into the hands of the left. If you run around and say America's an idea, they'll say, well, of course, but we never lived up to it. This is why we got to change all this stuff. You see, that's the point. And they get caught in this all the time. And again, I'll talk about that on tomorrow's show. But again, the great George Neumeier, of course, unfortunately passed away. This is one of the last several pieces that he wrote for American Spectator. Very good, hard-hitting piece on Glenn Youngkin and this stupid position of not, you know, trying to stop the renaming of Virginia's community colleges. All right, I'll see you tomorrow on the Brion McClanahan Show. See you then.